Hello everyone and welcome to today's session and continuing our philosophy series. Now this request I had got from a student to talk about Tagore's philosophy, Rabindranath Tagore's philosophy. And this is something that actually we don't know about, we've not heard about also. So let's do this one for today and let me share my screen quickly. So Tagore talks about a lot of philosophical ideas, Rabindranath Tagore. And the most, striking one is what he talks about as nationalism in Japan. Now, this is a political philosophy also, you could say, not just a normal philosophy, but a political philosophy as it is. So he talks about, and this is from his memoirs, from Rabindranath Tagore's original memoirs. So it talks about the worst form of bondage is the bondage of dejection. Dejection when you are hopeless, when you feel that nothing is going to happen. So that bondage of hopelessness. Bondage means slave, when you are trapped. So that trap, when you're trapped in a feeling of hopelessness, which keeps men hopelessly chained in loss of faith in themselves. And this makes people lose faith in themselves, lose confidence, the bondage of hopelessness, the cage of hopelessness. We have been repeatedly told with some justification that Asia lives in the past. Now this he talks about that the Western people, the European and the American people used to say that Asia always lives in its past. It talks about its past glory, but currently they don't do anything. You know, it is like a rich mausoleum which displays all of his magnificence in trying to immortalize the dead. Which is like a rich mausoleum is like a ground where you bury people. It's like Taj Mahal is a mausoleum where somebody is buried, to maqbara jisko as we call in Urdu or Hindi. And so it is like a grand cemetery where people are buried, the dead is buried, and we are trying to immortalize, we are trying to make them great, but actually there is nothing in the present. So we are just looking in the past to, glorify ourselves. It was said of Asia that it would never move in the path of progress. Its face was so inevitably turned backwards. So since we are only looking at the past, how can we move forwards and that forward? And that is what was supposedly said about Asia and the culture that Asia talked about. And we accepted this accusation and came to believe it. And we accepted it also, the Asians comprising of the different countries that were there, because we definitely talked about our past. In India, I know a large section of our educated community grown tired of feeling the humiliation of this charge against us is trying all its resources of self-deception to turn it into a matter of boasting. So now Rabindranath Tagore is saying that in India also, we feel this charge that you're always talking about your past. So we try to change this deception of talking about the past and try to, show as it as a matter of boasting. But boasting is only a mass shame. So that is, again, he's saying that it's actually not, it's just a superiority complex, which is you're showing as actually a inferiority complex. It does not truly believe in itself. So we are actually not believing in ourselves, even in our past when we talk about it, because that is already gone. When things stood like this, we in Asia hypnotized ourselves into the belief that it could never be any possibility be otherwise. And Japan rose from her dreams. So here, while the rest of Asia was dreaming about only their past, and we thought or koi possibility, there's no way, other way that we could understand, Japan rose from her dreams and in giant strides left centuries of inaction behind. In giant strides means in giant steps, took great steps of progress and left its centuries, hundreds of years of inaction, as we call it. It left it behind and moved forward. And how did it happen? So overtaking the present time in its foremost achievement. So the first and foremost achievement was that it overtook the present time and moved to the future. Aaj bhi nahi, they moved into the future. And this has broken the spell under which we lay in torpor for ages. So this has broken that spell under which we were like hypnotized. In torpor means like in a coma-like state, in a dormant state. We were there in a hibernating stage. For ages, we were inside it. Japan has broken that spell. And taking it to the normal condition of certain races living in certain geographical limits. And now we talk about Japan has taken us forward from this inactivity into a certain races living in certain geographical limits, and we try to make the best of it. We forgot that in Asia, great kingdoms were founded. Philosophy, science, art, and literature flourished. So we had forgotten our glorious past, that actually we had done these things. So why can't we do it again? And all the great religions of the world had their cradles. Cradles means all the great religions of the world started from Asia. And therefore, it cannot be said that there is anything inherent in soil and climate of Asia to produce mental inactivity. So there is nothing in Asia, nothing in the environment of Asia to produce people who are inactive or who are useless. And to atrophy the faculties, to atrophy means to sort of paralyze. The faculties means the gifts that we have, which impel men to go forward. So there is nothing that Asia does which makes you go backwards. There's something that has happened to us. For centuries, we did hold torches of civilization in the East when the West slumbered in darkness. So the West made dark ages. Nothing was happening, but we were taking forward our civilizations. And that could never be a sign of sluggish mind or narrowness of vision. And this cannot be said that the mind of Asians was sluggish means slow, or there was narrowness of vision of the future. We were visionaries because we had great empires, great learning, great literature. And that's what he talks about. Then fell the darkness of the night upon the lands of the East. And then there was some darkness. What was this? The current of time seems to stop at once. The time seemed to stop. And Asia ceased to take any new food feeding upon its own past. And suddenly we just stopped progressing and we just started eating our past, you know, eating on what we had done before and not moving forward. And which is really feeding, and it's like feeding on your own body. So finally you die. The stillness seemed like death. And the great voice was silent, which sent forth messages of eternal truth that saved man's life. So somewhere the great voice, the conscience, the inside, you know, the fire inside us had stopped somewhere. And for generations, like the ocean of air that keeps the earth sweet, ever cleansing its impurities. So just like this voice, the voice which moved us forward had stopped. And just like the ocean of air, which, you know, keeps cleaning the impurities around us, the voice that was inside us had stopped pushing us forward. So, but life has its sleep, its period of inactivity. Now he's saying that if this happens, it's okay. We in everyday life, we sleep and we have inactivity. When it loses its movement, takes no new food, living upon its past storage, then it grows helpless. Its muscles relax and it easily lends itself to be jeered for its stupor. So then what happens once you are inactive and you start feeding on yourself, because your body draws nourishment from itself. Similarly, the civilization also is like that. And then it is jeered upon. Jeered means people make fun of it. In the rhythm of life, pauses there must be for the renewal of life. So yes, in the rhythm, in the cycle of life, there has to be pauses. There have to be breaks. Nobody is on a high all the time. There have to be lows. There have to be periods of inactivity, but only for some time. And this life and its activity is ever spending, burning all of its fuel. This extravagance cannot go on indefinitely. So we cannot go on burning our fuel indefinitely. We need to stop and rest. We need to pause. But it is always followed by a passive stage. So this active stage is followed by a passive stage. And that is where the West was making fun of Asia and the Asian countries. And when all its expenditures stopped and adventures abandoned in favor of rest and slow recuperation. Recuperation is when you get energized and when you regrow and when you, you know, just heal yourself. That is the period of inactivity, just like hibernation in animals. You just keep quiet and wait for that time to pass, and then they come out of it. The tendency of mind is economical. It loves to form habits. Now, the mind has a tendency to form habits and move in grooves which save it the trouble of thinking anew at each of its. So we are a, you know, slave of our habits, and we don't try to change our habits because the mind gets used to it. Ideals once formed make the mind lazy. It becomes afraid to think of its acquisitions, its fresh endeavors. It tries to enjoy complete security by shutting its belongings behind the fortification of habits. So here he's saying that the habits, what it does is it makes us go in our comfort zone, and we are just behind that fort of our habits. We don't try to change anything or do anything new. The living ideals must not lose their touch with the growing and changing life. But in reality, we cannot do that. Their real freedom is not within the boundaries of security, but in the high road of adventure. So the reality of life is in the adventure of life, the being forward, full of risk, of new experiences. One morning, the whole world looked up in surprise. And this happened in the case of Japan. It just woke up one day. The whole world looked up in surprise when Japan broke through her walls of old habits in a night and came out triumphant. And Japan came out as a winner. It had broken its old habits, so it came out as a winner. It was done in an incredibly short time that it seemed like a change of dress and not like a building of a new structure. It was not done slowly. It was done just like, you know, just like you go and you change your dress and you come. So it was very fast, very instant. She showed the confidence, strength of maturity and freshness and infinite potential of new life. So Japan showed the potential of new life, new happenings. And at the same moment, immediately, the fear that entertained that it was a mere freak of history, a child's game of time, and that fear that it was a freak of history means it's a rarity. It will not happen all the time. The blowing up of a soap bubble. So it was like a soap bubble just broke, perfect in its rondure and coloring. So like a soap bubble is there. It's round and color. Rondure means round and color, but it is something which is not permanent. So hollow in its hearts and without substance. So similarly, like the soap bubble, it was like we were just hiding behind it. Japan was hiding behind it. But Japan had proved conclusively that the sudden revealment of her power was not a short-lived wonder. Everybody was saying that this Japan's sudden activity is like a soap bubble, very perfect, but it will go away. And Japan said that no, it is not a short-lived wonder, a chance product of time and tide. It is not just a by chance that time has produced this rarity of action in Japan, thrown up from the depth of obscurity to be swept away the next moment into the sea of oblivion. So here they are saying that it was not suddenly that tide had thrown something from the depth of the sea, and now it will again go back with the sea into oblivion, means being unknown. The truth is that Japan is old and new at the same time. Now see, this is paradoxical. This is contradictory. It's old and new at the same time. How? She has a legacy of ancient culture from the East. So the culture of Japan from the East is there. The culture that enjoins man to look after his true wealth and power in his inner soul. So we look inside for our strength. That is the culture that Japan has got. And the culture that gives self-possession in the face of loss and danger. Self-sacrifice without counting the cost or hoping for gain. Defiance of death, acceptance of countless social obligations that we owe to men as social beings. So this is the old culture of Japan, which it keeps alive. Japan keeps the old culture alive. In a word, modern Japan has come out of the immemorial East like a lotus blossoming with easy grace, and all the while keeping its firm hold upon the profound depth from which it has sprung. So Japan, the author has compared here with a lotus. He's given a metaphor of a lotus, that Japan is like a lotus which holds its soil, profound depth. It holds its depth, its soil, and yet it has blossomed into a new image of itself. And so this was a little, just a window into Rabindranath Tagore's writing, who was obviously so respected as a philosopher, as an author, as a painter, as a freedom fighter. I mean, you name it, he has dabbled in everything. So history is rich, Indian history is rich because of his contribution. Culture is rich because of his contribution. I would like you to be reading more. This is Tagore on Nationalism. You can get the PDF from the net. And just try to read more. It's beautifully written and gives a lovely perspective to keep moving on in the future. So that was all from my side today. Please do like and share and leave your comments. It's really heartening to know that you are liking what we are putting here for you. So thank you very much. Bye-bye.